Hello, in this video we're going to show you how to set the crank end float on a Scott. Okay, we've got to rebuild this engine. This is one that came in. We've done all sorts of bits of work on it, new bearings and such like. We've replaced the flywheel, which you can see in one of our other videos, and we've got our parts laid out here for the bottom end. So, you know, the bottom end on a Scott, we have the flywheel that sits in the center, we have two crank halves, we have the sealing glands which run on the main bearing faces, we have the springs for those glands, and we have bearing rollers, 15 rollers. These are 1/4 inch wide, 3/8 diameter, which I believe until middle of last year were unobtainable. We made 5,000 of them, so we have a lifetime supply, maybe two lifetime supply, because we had to get them all made at once in the States. I think we might be the only place in the world that actually sells those at the moment. But anyway, the way we assemble this up is that we'll put grease around this main bearing ring. The idea of the grease is that it will hold the rollers in place while we assemble it into our crankcase here in our fixture. The final assembly, we will have spring goes on for the sealing gland, and the sealing gland sits over the top of that, so it's sprung loaded. But actually what we're going to do is we're going to assemble this entire bottom end of the engine up first with no springs in and no shims. So we're just going to assemble the cranks, the glands and the flywheel. We're going to knock it up to make sure it's tight, and we're going to measure the end float. While we're doing that, we're going to make sure it actually does have some end float. And then once we've measured that with everything knocked up, we will take the entire assembly apart again. We will add the appropriate number of shims on one or both sides, depending how many we need, and the shims sit between this bearing face here and the gland face, in order to restrict the end float of the crank. We're aiming for about 14 thou. That's your typical kind of number, 0.35, 0.4 millimetres. So we'll put the appropriate number of shims in, we will then put the springs in, we'll assemble everything up finally, and then we will check it again. And once we've done that, we should be done on this, and the bottom end of this engine should be good to go, and we can get the top end rebuilt. So, first job. We're going to put some grease around the bearings here and put 15 rollers onto each crank half, and then we'll put the flywheel everything in place and we'll drop it into the crankcase and we'll show you doing that. Now obviously we're going to use our engine stand for this, so we're not chasing the engine around on the bench, and it makes it much easier to lay the crankcase on its side. And then what we do with the flywheel in place, we use this tool here, and I will assemble it up. That's the wrong half. Crank half with no thread we'll put in first, and what we'll do is we'll assemble this tool up from the bottom. We'll lay the crankcase on its side, we'll drop this one, the left hand crank, we'll drop it onto the pin with the rollers in place, and then we can lower it down from underneath, because obviously on this side there's nothing to get hold of to be able to lower it down by hand. So that's how we do it. We'll lower that down, then once that's in, we'll push it into the flywheel just to get it to hold on the taper, and then the other half of the crank, which has got the thread in, we can simply screw in the crank bolt a couple of turns, put the bearings around there, and then with the bearings on, we'll put the gland in the crankcase first, and then we can lower that down in, wiggle it in because the bearings are a good fit in the cups, and then that'll be set as well, and then we can take that bolt out, and then we'll assemble it from the other way correctly, tighten it up, knock the cranks up a couple of times on each side, and then we'll do some measuring so you'll be able to see us doing that. So I'm going to put the left hand side in first. As I said, I'm going to put this tool up through the centre of the flywheel, like this. On a Scott, this is a flyer, so we've got magneto sprocket, a gearbox sprocket. Obviously on a Scott, the drive side and goes on the left hand side, so we're going to face that upwards. So we'll pop our flywheel into here. We have on the left hand side crank, the sealing gland and the crank here. So we'll pop that in. We'll line up the gland tang with the keyway there. I'm not going to put the keyway in the flywheel yet, I'll do that from the other side after we've got this assembled. It just makes it a touch easier, that's all. The bearing, the big end bush, sticks out slightly over the edge of the crank, and on a Scott it has a notch in the crankcase, and on the left hand side we've got the keyway and the crank pin are on opposite sides. So what I'm going to do is the notch is here in this position, so I'm going to line up the keyway 90 degrees opposite that, so we're roughly in the right place. And you see I've got the engine secure here on our stand. So to assemble this, I will poke our tool up through the centre here. Obviously put the bearings in with some grease so that will line up. We will drop that over there like that. And you can see by doing this is that I've got nice control of that crank there. And I'm going to line up the big end so it goes through the notch in the crankcase. And then we will wiggle that in. Sometimes with the main bearing rollers it takes a little bit of wiggling to get it to sit. Especially on engines that have had the cups ground where the chamfers haven't been put back on. So there we are, that's gone in there. We'll turn it around a bit to get it to seat. There we are, it's sat in. So what we can do now, usually at this point I would just use a metal bar or something else like this. We'll pop that down through the crankcase on that side, so when I turn this over that crankcase doesn't fall out. And we'll turn this over here. Be able to see there the crank and the flywheel and the tang. I'll move the camera here. If you look down there, you can see the keyway, the crank half, and you can see the end of the tang sticking through into there. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to put the keyway down so that seats in there, and then we'll put the other half of the crank in, and then we can start knocking this up. Because on the right hand side the keyway and the notch in the crankcase you can see here need to line up. So I'll pop my bar back in the other side so that keeps it held. Here's our crank. I'm gonna, you can see that the crank pin bush and the keyway are lined up on this right hand side. I'll pop that in there. I've already put the gland in and made sure the tang's down into the keyway recess. And we'll just feel that into the taper. And the keyway. Yep, feels like it's in the keyway. And there we are, it's going down into there. So we'll take the bolt out. We can stand the engine up. Pull out our bar that was locking it. Put the bolt through the centre. And we can nip this up and see what we've got for end float. So we're just going to nick the crank centre bolt up here, and while I'm doing this I'm going to keep turning the flywheel to make sure that that's feeling free and everything's running okay. There is a chance on some engines with tired tapers that when you assemble them up with no shims in they'll still have no end float, so part of doing this is to make sure that we're not accidentally binding the engine up. Feeling very nice indeed. Right, we'll get our tools out and we'll start knocking this together in the vise. You'll be able to see us doing that. So I've nipped up that crank bolt firm by hand while I've been turning the flywheel to make sure that's free. So the first checks we do on this assembly is that we just spin the flywheel and make sure that the edge of the flywheel appears to be running true. If there's any sort of wobble or anything else, it means that usually it's because one of the glands hasn't seated properly into the keyway hole, and you can pull it apart and do something about it at this stage. but you really don't want to start knocking it together if something looks like it's running out of true. So everything should look true. The other thing to do is get a screwdriver or something else. Depends how tight the main bearings are. These are nice and fresh on this, so they're quite tight. And the idea is that I can just put this screwdriver down between the flywheel sprockets and the main cup, and I can just ease the crank across and make sure we've actually got some end float before we start knocking this up. So we'll just check that now. Yeah, that's okay. That's maybe got a couple of mil worth of end float. So when we knock this up, I expect that it's still going to have end float remaining, which is obviously a good thing. So we'll knock it up now. We've got our tools. Now, the Book of the Scot, when it comes to knocking up the cranks, sorry, just to go back a step, obviously we've got tapers on the cranks that fit into the flywheels. And part of the way of getting those to seat properly is to actually knock them in. You can't do it using the crank bolt. If you do it using the crank bolt, if you get it really tight, you might yield the bolt, or you might strip the threads in the crank, but it still won't be tight enough. You need to get these proper tight. And the way to do that is to knock them together. See, what you need to do is you need to react against one crank half while you knock the other one in, and then taking turns and do it two or three times on each side. And you can tell when it's been knocked up, because at the moment, the first time I knock this, and I'll video this and hope you can hear it, is that it will sound quite dead. And as the crank gets more knocked up, the flywheel will start to ring. And when that flywheel rings like a bell, it usually means that everything's seated properly. The Book of the Scot, the method that they suggest of doing this, is to have two people put the engine on a bench and have one person hold a heavy weight, like a lumpire or something, against one side of the engine, and then have somebody hit the other one, hit the crank using a drift or something, to be able to knock them together, to shock the tapers together. Yeah, that's one way that could work. I don't really like chasing engines around benches doing that, and also I'm doing this by myself. So actually the way that I do it is that I've got aluminium tooling that I bolt into my vise, and the tooling has the imprint of a crank half in it, because obviously the crank halves aren't flat. So what I do is I lay the engine on its side on the aluminium tooling on the vise. The aluminium tooling obviously is designed such that it'll react the load through the vise as a heavy mass, but the aluminium's not going to damage the cranks. So I will lay the engine on its side, one crank half downwards, so the crank case is completely free, it'll just rotate around. So there's no force at all going through the crank case. So the aluminium will sit on this area of the crank here, and then what I'll do is I've got a soft iron drift that I will use against the other crank, and I will use the lump hammer, because the idea is that we're not trying to tap this to get it together, we're trying to do a good solid blow that follows through and gets the force going into the tapers. So what I will do then, with the crankcase laid on its side and make sure the crankcase is free to rotate so there's no load, I will use this drift on the opposite crank half, and I'll hit it, I think Book of the Scot says from about 8 inches up, something like that, and I'll hit it from there like that, good solid bash, couple of times, like one on just on each side of where the bolt is, and then we'll turn the crank over and we'll do the same on the other side, and then we'll have, every time we do that, we'll have a nip of the bolt, because you'll find out that the bolt will go up maybe one or two turns, and actually when it starts to get knocked up you find out that the bolt doesn't go up anymore. We'll do that because I'm going to take this apart again, because I need to put the shims in. I'll do this twice on each side, and then we'll measure the end float. Now when I do this finally, I usually do it three times on each side, and that'll bring it up another 3 or 4 thou probably on the gap. So anyway, we'll get this crankcase out of the stand, we'll take it over to the vise, and you can see us knocking it up and nipping the bolts up. Yep, so just before we start, and for a bit of extra security, I'm going to put the candlestick in, which is this part here. So when we set the end float for an engine, it's best to do it in the condition that it sits within the bike frame. What we tend to find is that these cheeks here vary on the engines, and the candlestick, it's 5 inch is the spacer, so we'll put that in as a spacer and nip it up. The reason I'm putting this one in and not the bottom one is that on this engine I've put some slots in here, which I generally do because Scots have a square corner there as standard, and what you tend to find is that when the under tray wears, it wears away this surface on the crank here, so owners tighten and tighten and tighten the lower bolt that goes through here. It bends these in and it starts a crack that goes from that square corner. So by cutting these relief slots in, these are 8mm wide, 40mm long, by cutting these relief slots in, it just gives a little bit of movement in those, and it will prevent your crankcases cracking. It's a common problem on Scots to find out that these bottom lugs have been welded back on again when they've broken. So here's our fixture, our aluminium fixture in the vise that I talked about. So what I'm going to do, we'll start off putting the bolt side down. I'll align the big end bush so it goes into the recess that I've created in the tooling here. And we will drop that on, and that's machined such that it sits on there, so I can let go of that crankcase there and it's balanced, but obviously I'm not going to let go of it and walk away. So that's the crankcase is now free, and we can see that the flywheel's stationary because we sat on that lower crank. So what I can do now is that I can hit this top crank half, and it's going to react through that crank half, through the flywheel, into the other half of the crank and down into the vise here. And that way you can see the crankcase is completely free and I'm not putting any load at all through the bearings, which we definitely don't want to do. So soft iron drift, crank assembly tool, and we'll get that lined up there. That feels good. And this should sound reasonably dull the first time I hit this, and then it'll start ringing as we get it more knocked up. So that's free, everything's free, that's good. There we are. So I will nip up the crank bolt that we've got here, and I expect to find, yeah, do it this way around, you might be able to see that. So I'm just going to nip this bolt up, and you can see actually that was nipped up before, and now that bolt's free, I can do that with my fingers. That's obviously where the cranks have closed in. So I'm just going to pop this drift down there, lock the crank, I will tighten up that bolt, and then we'll do the other side, make sure that's free. Yep, that's good. Yeah, we're going to need a few shims in this one, I think. Which is good, that means it's a healthy flywheel. So that time I'd laid the crank down on the bolt head there, so we're going to go the other way up this time. That's there, and I've got a hole in here in this tool that the centre crank bolt will fit down into, such that we don't end up hitting the crank bolt rather than anything else. I can feel that's going in there. Yeah, it's free. Get the alignment on there, that's okay. And we're going to punch the assembly tool again, and basically I know that if that bolt's tight after I've knocked it up that time, it means they haven't moved it any further, so that's a good thing. It means that this crank is knocked up. We're going to put it back in our fixture on the bed there. We'll get the dial test indicator against the side of the crank here, and we'll have a look and see what end plate we've got. Then we can pull it all apart, put some shims in, put the springs in, put it all back together again. So what I've done here to check the end float is that I've mounted the aluminium crankcase into this steel cradle that sits on our engine, on our engine stand. So what I can do is I can use a mag stand, the dial test indicator, and the dial test indicator presses on the side of the crank. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make sure that the flywheel is all the way over one way here, and usually the best way to do that is just to use a small screwdriver and just gently work it over between the between the main cup and the flywheel sprockets. Get that right over there. I'm going to zero in the dial gauge. It's on zero there. I'm going to put the screwdriver on the other side and we just gently wiggle it across. And over we go. And see what we measure. I said this engine felt like it was going to have a lot of end flight. And we're over there, and that is reading 1.197 millimetres. So okay, if we're going to get our targets on this, I would generally set it up at about 0.4. So 0.4 millimetres, this is going to need, so I'm going to do it 0.4, but I'm going to knock it up a little bit more than last time. That's why I'm doing 0.4, I'm aiming to get 0.35 when we're finished. So on the distance that we've got here, I need 0.8 millimetres worth of shims in this engine, and that should give us the right end float. So the next thing to do is I'm going to shift it across the flywheel again. I'm going to double check the measurements, and then we're going to pop this apart and look and see what it's got. Shims, I've got loads of shims, so what we'll do is we'll take this apart now, we'll measure up the shims we need. I'll probably put about 0.6 worth of shims in this, and we'll obviously try and do it evenly, like 0.3 each side, depending on the exact stack of the shims that I've got, and we'll assemble it back up and we'll see what we've got. One final point on shimming is that when you shift the flywheel with no shims in all the way one way and the other, what you can find is that if the gland faces have been ground, you might end up with one gland that's thinner than the other. So you need to check when the flywheel's all the way over one way and the other way that you've actually got clearance to the main cups, and that the rivet heads and sprockets aren't touching the main cups. If they are, obviously you can make note of that and you can put slightly more shims into the what would be the opposite side to stop the crank going over quite so far if you need to. So you can adjust the central position using the shims a little bit. Okay, so there's the point on that, 0.67 worth of shims. So we're going to take this apart now and have a look and get that sorted out. So crank removal is maybe one of the more controversial Scott topics, how to actually get the cranks out of an engine. Now, according to the book of the Scott, what we should do is that we should slacken the centre crank bolt two or three turns, and then we should hit the end of that bolt in order to shot the opposite side crank out. Now, one of the problems doing that is that you end up risking reacting against the main cups, and if you do that you can end up knocking the cup out of the crankcase, which is a really bad thing and you don't want to be doing that. But obviously if the crank has been knocked up properly and the tapers are in hard, it's very difficult to get them apart. You know, if you're used to knocking Morse tapers apart on machine tools, you'll know that if they've had a bit of force in and they've got stuck together, you know, they take a bit of moving. So one of the ways to do it is, so firstly I wouldn't recommend hitting to do the primary release on the end of that bolt. I don't mind tapping that bolt once we've got the primary taper released. That's okay, we can do that just to knock it out. But I don't want to do the primary release from the taper using that. We also risk knocking the threads out. So the other way of doing it is to take the approach as you would with car ball joints and this kind of thing, is that you try and shock it at 90 degrees to the direction of the taper. So on a Scott, the way to do that is to slacken the centre bolt, which I've already done it here. So just slacken that off a couple of turns, and then before we try and take the crank apart and tap it, I've got this tool here, which is, again, it's a soft iron drift, and I've machined into this the exact radius of the Scott crank pins. Now, I realise some people may spit into the Horlicks I've spitholics all over the keyboard at this point. I accept Scots have delicate cranks and there's no easy way of getting these things apart. But if you shock, if you put the crank into this position with the big end eye at 90 degrees, I can put this drift down to the top of the barrel opening there. It fits exactly onto the bearing, so I'm not going to damage the bearing surface doing this. And I can give that a sharp blow with a hammer, and I can then turn it around the other way, 90 degrees the other way, and do the same thing. So what I'm going to do to try and give the primary release onto that taper is I'm going to do that a couple of times on each side. So in effect I'm going to do it once here, then back to here, second time here. I'll then do it on the other side of the crank, I'll turn it around and do it on that side of the crank. And that should just open it up very slightly. You might only need a thou or two of movement, and it's enough to really break that hard taper seal. And once I've done that, I will then give it a tap on the end here on this bolt, and it should extract that right hand crank half. Once that's extracted, I'm going to use my tool here that we showed you earlier for the assembly. I'm going to put this down and I'm going to use it to tap the other half out of the crank, and that should allow us to disassemble this. So those of a sensitive disposition may wish to look away now. I guess another point is that if you can knock an engine apart just by tapping that bolt, it probably means it wasn't knocked up properly in the first place. So when I'm hitting this, I'm going to use a sharp blow. I'm not going to try and restrain the flywheel at all, I'm just going to let that rotate round. Because again, all we're trying to do is just shock this apart, I'm not trying to bash it through the bottom of the engine and the bench at the same time. And in fact, that made a dull sound when I did that, which means that I think this side is freed off. Do that exactly the same on the other side of the engine, and then we'll see if we've got this free. There we are, you can see it's sharp blows, that's all. I'm not trying to smash the thing through to Australia, or if you're in Australia of course, to the UK. So I'm going to lay it on its side here, we've got our crank bolt upwards, so I'm going to tap it on this crank bolt now and it should release the lower half. I've only unscrewed that crank bolt about three turns, because if I try and knock it all the way through, I've got to be careful that the big end bush is lined up with that notch in the crankcase, because otherwise you'll have two notches in your crankcase, which I've seen on a few Scott cases. So by only undoing it a couple of turns, it means that I can free that off and then I can turn it over, make sure it's aligned and pull it out. I'm just actually putting my hand in here to steady the flywheel while I'm doing this. There we are, that's that side out. So what I will do, I'll unscrew the crank bolt here. Eventually. And put it back in this side in the thread. Turn the engine on its side. Turn it round so I line up the big end bush. And then we can extract this. We can extract this crank half. There we are. And if I keep that like that, it means the rollers are already in place, so I can reassemble it. There's our gland from that side. So now I'm going to use my tool that we showed you earlier with the keyway slot and such like in it. I can put that down through there. lift the engine up on the stand here. I'm going to rotate it around so that big end eye lines up with the eyelet there. And then I can make sure that we can tap this out. Now what I'm doing when we're doing this is that at the moment there's a gap between that sprocket and the main cup. And when I tap it on this end, I'm going to make sure we maintain that gap, because if we do that, it means I'm just reacting against the flywheel. There's nothing going through the mains, which is obviously a good thing. So there we are, that's lined up. That's lined up. I'll put my hand inside the crankcase again up against the flywheel. There we are, that's coming out nicely. Lay it down so it doesn't pour the bearings all over the place. And there we are, complete with key weight. Right, so that's our engine disassembled. We can leave the flywheel in there because we're going to put it all back together in the reverse order. But all I'm going to do this time is that I'm going to find some crank shims of the appropriate size. We'll measure them up and I'll put 0.6 mm of crank shims, 0.3 each side if I've got the right size shims. They fit in there. Go over the crank like that. I'll put the gland springs in, put the gland on, make sure the gland is seating right up against the spring, because sometimes the spring ends can get a bit bent. In fact, that one's not perfect, so usually you just turn the spring around and put it in the other way up, and it seats okay. Yeah, that's better. Make sure that everything is seating up, and if that's okay, we can assemble all this up, do a final knock up, check the end float, and the bottom end of this engine should be good to go. So we've done our final knock-up on this engine here, three times each side, four hits per side that we've done there. So what we're going to do now, we'll get the dial gauge on, we'll check the end float and make sure that's exactly where we hope it would be. Just for info, the target end float, we usually set them out with the candlestick in place, is 12 to 16 thou. 14 thou is our aiming point for that, but you know, we've got to accept we're going to be a couple of thou each way because of the nature of the cranks and the tapers. Setting them at that sort of distance seems okay. I wouldn't recommend going any tighter, and to be honest, I've seen some that have had 30 thou and actually the engines have run fine. You know, typically with two strokes, I think you tend to find if there's excess end float, what happens is that when the engine's running, the crank just tends to find its way across one way or the other, and it'll just stay in that position. But anyway, 14 thou is our aiming point, plus minus 2 thou, which is that 12 to 16 thou. And so we'll measure this up and see where we are with it. 16 thou is 0.4, so 0.3 to 0.4 is our distance in millimetres. Well, we'll measure it up and see what we've got. This is our dial gauge up against the side of the engine there. And we'll try and do this left-handed. See if this will work. Turn the camera around the right way, so that's going to read the right way up. So all I'm going to do is go down and gently with the screwdriver in between the main cups and just gently ease that across all the way one way. There we are. And we go across to our dial gauge. That's set now at 5 microns. If you can see that without the light getting in the way. There we are. And I'll go into the other side. And we will gently lever that across. And this engine is at 0.37 millimetres on the end float, which is 10 a bit over 14 thou. So that will do very nicely. There we are. We'll double check those measurements and then we'll deal with the crank bolt. The next job that we do now is obviously we've put the crank bolt in. Let me spin this round, make sure I've not put the dial gauge on anything. We've put the crank bolt in and everything's dry. What I'll do is I'll take the crank bolt out and then we'll have a talk about that. So I've taken our crank bolt out. Obviously because we've knocked the tapers together, everything's stuck firm anyway on this engine. But this is a Scott crank bolt. We've got the head here with a slight taper under it. A straight section. We've got, off the top of my head, this is a 3/8 right hand thread, and then a 5/16 left hand thread. So what we do is we tighten that into the crank using the right hand thread, and then the idea is to use this left hand nut as a lock nut. And what we do is, when that left hand nut has been put on, usually a dot punch the thread on this end. But actually, using more modern things, my preferred way actually is that usually I cut off the left hand threaded end portion of this bolt, clean the parts with a brake cleaner or solvent cleaner or something, and I use a standard grade of nut lock and tighten this bolt up proper tight with a breaker bar. I have seen these engines put together with this, which is Loctite 638 retainer. That seems like a great idea at the time, until you want the thing apart again. And actually, there's been a couple of engines I've had where people have assembled them up with retainer, and I've had to drill the head of the bolt off, take the cranks apart, and then heat up the crank to be able to break the Loctite to be able to get that thread out. So it's not a good idea to use retaining compound. I just use normal nut grade stuff, which in the Loctite range is something like Threadlock at 270. Please don't use 638 if you ever want to take it apart again. I'll have some sympathy for the poor guy that's going to. Right, okay, so on this one, this has got the left hand thread, so I'm just going to cut this off now, clean up the end of that thread, and then we don't have to use that left hand lock nut. And obviously the reason for doing that is that the less parts we've got inside the engine with the potential of coming out, being Murphy's Law, the better, really. So why would you use this if we can replace it with this? So that's the next job on this. We'll put this bolt in, we'll tighten it up nice and tight, and then the bottom end of this engine is finished. There we are, I've cleaned up the end of this bolt. I've already washed it off, so we'll put a bit of the locking compound on there. We haven't smothered it. We'll pop the bolt in. Run it up here. I'll put my crank blocker on the right side of where we're going. Stick this on here. Apologies, I'm going to have to stand in front of the camera to do this. Nice and tight, and obviously that's one of the great things with having these engine stands, is that I was doing that by myself with the engine in there, and I'm not chasing the thing around a bench trying to do it. So that's it, the bottom end of this engine's done. We've got 14 thou end flow, which is exactly what we were aiming for, and the next job on this now is I'm going to put the conrods on, and going to put the barrel on, check compression ratios and things, so that will be one of our other videos. But anyway, there you go, that's how to assemble Scott cranks, or it's our way of assembling Scott cranks, I'm not saying it's the only one, but that's how we go about assembling Scott cranks, measuring end float, setting end float, and also disassembling the cranks when they've been put together quite tightly as well. Okay, hope you enjoyed it, keep watching out for more videos.